So this this table is quite important to understand the mechanism, because it's the table responsible of the different behavior of during the task submission. So normally, application shouldn't need to specify an input file. By the way, there are many cases where application have a default set of input files to provide. So in order to help developers or help users to have a much lighter task submission command lines, there is this table where you can specify which are the default input files for a specific application. Here there is a simple example. For instance, there exists an application that has the default Tosca template YAML file describing the resources to be created by the orchestrator. And the second file is the shell script that will be executed inside the created resource. So those files never changes, because those are not changeable normally by the user. There is no need that the user specify each time those commands, those files. So in this way, you can specify default input files. And you provide the name and the location where the file is located. Then there is this flag override. And the meaning is, OK, I have default files, but I want to give, but the user, using the command line, can specify its own file. So a malicious user could send another shell script that will do bad things on the remote infrastructure. So for instance, if you specify both files having the override flag true, and you send the request to submit the task will start immediately. So will behave in the, you issue the first call. Do you remember the post call to submit a task? So you issue this command, and the task will start immediately. If the flags are zero or false, the task will wait that the user submit the files. If the user sends this second call to finalize the task submission, the files specified in the table will be used. Otherwise, if the user specify a specific file here, with the minus F option, et cetera, the files specified by the user will be used instead of the default ones. OK, after the application file, we can have a look on the configuration to target a specific infrastructure. And the following slides are showing what happens for to configure SSH or CCI, WMS, or Tosca. Let's start from the most simple one. You have this is the table that specify the infrastructure parameters. In infrastructure parameter, you specify which is the JSAGA job service, and in this case you are specifying that you want to target SSH, which is the host name of the SSH that is listening to, and the port of SSH, the username, and the password. So this is really the most easy configurable way to execute something with the FutureGateway APIs. A more complex configuration is here, defining RO CCI entry point for JSAGA. I remember you, OCCI is a protocol to start up a virtual machine using a standard protocol. OCCI installs for you the virtual machine, and then this adapter is able to submit something inside this virtual machine and retrieve the output back. So in order to do this, you have to specify which is the entry point of OCCI, listening for OCCI calls, which kind of resource you want to instantiate, which kind of physical resource will have the virtual appliance, then the name of the virtual machine, and then you can see here a set of calls specifying the credential needed by the OCCI entry point to execute, to instantiate the virtual machine. So the credentials are coming from a third party service called the eToken server, and these are the necessary configuration value to instruct this service. Then there exists also the possibility to specify further further parameters in the job service row. And here there is a little example. So of course the host, the port, but you can also specify other options here, but I don't want to go in details now about this. So for instance, how much shall I wait before to raise an exception that the virtual appliance has not been created in time, the name of the virtual appliance, etc. To whom is more practice with the grid environment? Again, we have here the entry point of the WMS against which I want to execute a job. The LDAP parameters specifying. And then again, the robot proxy certificate details. So the configuration values to get a robot proxy certificate that will be right to execute this job. In Tosca, the scenario is simple as well. You have to specify the entry point of the orchestrator. The entry point normally is terminates with deployments. In the future, you have, but I think now development people developing the orchestrator is requires the token. So the token will be written here. Then, which will be the YAML file describing the Tosca resource, and the other parameters related to the creation of the resource. So how much time I have to wait before raise an exception, etc., etc. We can now watch the APIs related to the application management. So of course we can list applications just providing the entry point applications. So we'll get the full list of applications installed on the Future Gateway. We have all details in the returned JSON. We can get the details of a specific application, continuing the entry point with the application ID. In order to create an application, exactly like you do with the task submission, you specify a post data, a JSON content that is specifying the details of the application. There is an example on the next slide. To delete an application, again, you have to specify the action that must be deleted and the application ID. So the entry point is applications, application ID. This is a JSON, a very simple JSON explaining how I define an application in order to be installed on the Future Gateway. This is the field that specifies if the application is a job or infrastructure. Then the description, what does the application, the name of the application. You can switch off this application. So if you switch off this application, nobody will be able to create a task related to this application. And then application parameters, so the target executor in this case, which is the executable, the output file, the error file. Then there is the section specifying the infrastructure. So we have an array with many infrastructure available. Each infrastructure will have their own its own parameters. So in the case of SSH, I can provide here the entry point, the username, and the password. So this is the post data, and this is the entry point. Again, applications. So till now, the token management has been has not covered, and next slides we'll talk about the token management. So let's start with the baseline token management provided by the baseline installation. So if I don't want to use Indigo Way, if I don't want to use the Catania Science Gateway framework authentication and authorization, I don't have nothing on my site. I want just to, at least also for testing purposes. So this is the mechanism provided by the baseline. We already seen this slide in the overview. So the first thing to do is to reach this out entry point, specifying in the header section this string, authorization, comma, column, bearer, and then a log token. This value, this log token, has to be created using the key configured on the API server front-end. So there exists on the source codes a little Python code called mklogtoken that helps you to create such a log token. So in the code of this little script can be used for instance, for to generate those log tokens from a web interface on the portal. So once you get the section token from this call, you can use any kind of you can use any REST API specifying in the header authorization, column, and the section token. There is another way to get a session token. You can even use out, providing in the parameters the username and the password. In such a case, it's highly suggested to use HTTPS protocol, because username and password are coming in the stream. So this is another possibility you may have. This is for what concerns the baseline setting. In Indigo, this mechanism is totally unused. The mechanism, as I told you, is that the user connects to the portal. The portal provides the authentication and the authorization interface. From authorization and authentication, I get only a token. The token will be used to contact the API server, and the API server will check each incoming token with the portal, because the portal is providing an entry point where I can check the token. Then the token will be used to access or not to the resources. So in order to accomplish this, there is a feature in the configuration file named the portal token validator. And what you have to specify is in the configuration file is that you want this kind of authentication and authorization. And you have to provide which is the entry point that the portal provides you to check the validity of the tokens. So here you are kind of HTTPS entry point. This entry point will require credentials, so a username and a password. And the answer of this check will be the portal username if the user is authenticated, authorized, the group the user belongs, but the username and groups are an optional answer. The API server will use the information coming from this check to map the portal user with the users that are defined on the future gateway. So there is no, potentially there is no match one-to-one between API server user and portal users. Of course, you may have a configuration where you have a mapping one-to-one between portal users and API server users. So this is very useful, for instance, when you want to group portal users. For instance, the portal serves biomedics and biomedics users and another discipline-based community. And you want to group memberships in those two groups. Then, of course, the application defined on the API server, there are applications serving the one community and applications serving another community. So grouping with two different users, with the two different groups in the API server, you can have just two users here in API server serving two communities in the portal. So in order to specify which will be the mapping between the portal and the API server, there exists in the installation this FG API server underscore PTV map. It's a JSON file that specifies the rules where that will map the portal user with the API server, the future gateway users. Those are some roles available. So for instance, a user can install application or can do changes on the application definition. Users can or not delete application, view application details, such kind of operations. The roles are normally applied to groups so that users are linked to groups. So in order to use API, till now we have seen curl commands. Of course, web pages are not using curl. On our experiences, on our examples, till now we used Ajax to provide execute API calls and Liferay portlets. Of course, the use of REST APIs opens to any kind of language or any kind of web technology. And as you have seen before, sometimes infrastructure requires credential in form of proxy certificates. And in such cases, we are using a third party service named eToken Server. And if you need this, it's necessary to open a VPN section between your future gateway instance and this third-party service, eToken server. Or you have to open your IP address or your future gateway IP address against the firewall in the eToken server service. But this is really a detail now. This is the way to call API server using Ajax, for instance. You can see this kind of example in GitHub. I use this for Hello Tester. In the case of portlets, we are supporting by the installation script Liferay 6.2 and Liferay 7. And in this slide, you have described the steps to generate the portlet code from the SDK. And in case of Liferay 7, this method is totally different. And you have here a documentation link pointing to the instruction on how to develop with Liferay. Again, information about VPN, but this is in case you want to develop an application and you need proxy certificates, then you have to request us the access to this e-token service. And there are links, emails, our emails, in order to get the access to this VPN service that helps you to connect to the e-token server service. So this concludes the API section.